Science on the Screen. Today is my pleasure to present Raul Machado. He's graduated in applied biology, has a master in molecular genetics and a PhD in biology with a specialization in biotechnology, specifically in materials science and engineering. And he also has a post-graduation in management. As you will see, Raul is a man of the seven instruments. So he has a lot of interests in his career. Presently is assistant researcher at the CBMA and vice director of the IBS, the Institute of Science and Innovation for Biosustainability, both from the University of Minho. And he has also a position as a teacher, as an invited assistant professor for entrepreneurship at the School of Economics and Management at the University of Minho. He is also an expert evaluator and an expert monitor for the European Commission for the Research Executive Agency. And he has been involved in a lot of evaluations, and also he is also PI and coordinator of a series of research projects as a PI and as a team member. Now, his current research interests are focused on the development of multifunctional bio-inspired protein-based materials for biomedical applications, especially antimicrobials and materials for wound healing. And is also particularly interested in the development of biocomposites for the formulation of sustainable, eco-friendly, value-added materials. So it is in brief, his research interests. But in addition to these research interests, Raul is also actively engaged in entrepreneurship activities, acting as a consultant mentor for entrepreneurial seed projects in different networks. For instance, the IAPMEI, the startup Braga, Tecminho, Setup Guimarães. So he is the right person if you are interested ever in opening and being an entrepreneur. So you can talk to Raul. He is your mentor and he can be your mentor and advisor. So Raul, thank you very much for accepting to this invitation, and the stage is yours.
Okay, so thank you for the kind presentation. I'd like to also to thank the organization for this invitation. It's with great pleasure that I'm here to present some of the research or the past research we have been doing in our lab. And as as you can see from the title, I will focus today in the genetically engineered protein polymers. So I also would like to thank especially the Professor Cecília Paes. She was, for you to know, she was my supervisor during my graduation in applied biology. And also it is with great pleasure to be here with Andrea Pacheco. I know Andrea since, well, we were, I think, 15 or 16 years old. So it's quite some time. So regarding what moved us to be here, I will talk about the research that I've been developing. And just a brief introduction. I am an assistant researcher of the CBMA, the Center of Molecular and Environmental Biology from University of Minho. And CBMA is a research center from the School of Sciences with main focus on biodiversity and the sustainable use of natural resources. And the research center is based on three pillars: research, advanced training, and society. Nowadays, it consists of 56 integrated members and more than 30 PhD students, and the research areas include the monitoring and management of aquatic biodiversity, the development of strategies towards adaptation of aquatic ecosystem to global change, the development of theoretical and computational models for sustainable ecosystems, the identification of molecular targets relevant for biotechnology, including value-added compounds, and the development of bio-inspired systems to create innovative products. The IBS is an institute stemming from an initiative of CVMA and ISIS. ISIS is the Institute for Sustainability and Innovation in Structural Engineering, and the IBS comprises two infrastructures, one in Braga, this one, related mainly with biology and environment, and another one in Guimarães, related with engineering and technology. So IBS promotes interdisciplinary science-based innovation, focused in the sustainability grand challenges, and is oriented towards value co-creation with society, academia, industry, and government. And the main thematic areas are involved the study of biodiversity, ecosystem services and natural capital, resilience of natural and built environments, space, oceans, coastal and inland waters, and circular economy and bio-based solutions. In our research group that we turned as SIN Biotech, our main focus is in the development of, our group is dedicated to the development of eco-designed bio-inspired multifunctional materials by employing or by following a biotechnological approach while employing materials science principles. And we are, as a general overview, we are focused in the development of bio-based performance materials. So we design materials by learning from natural proteins and produce by following a molecular biotechnology approach using recombinant DNA technology and microorganisms as cell factories. And we increase the complexity of the recombinant protein design by genetically engineering the sequence to incorporate functional domains, functionalization by genetic engineering, or by incorporation of functional fillers. And in all this approach, we take always in consideration the ecological and economic sustainability through process optimization involving mainly the optimization of the production conditions and improving the processing conditions to minimize the ecological impact. So regarding what I am here to present you, in nature, among the natural proteins, the structural proteins are remarkable examples of materials with outstanding mechanical performance, showing unmatched biocompatibility and biodegradability. And we can find these proteins fulfilling an assortment of different roles. We can find these proteins in nature as acting as impact absorbers, as for energy store for running in flight and swimming, acting as flow smoothers, for instance, in arteries, or even to improve the elasticity in organs like the lungs or the skin, acting as power amplifiers. And in here we can see this is the leg of a grasshopper, and we can see it acts as a power amplifier for the insect to jump. These structural proteins also play an important role in protective covering, for instance, as we have our hair is mainly composed of keratin, and they act also as structural support and prey catching. So indeed, these structural proteins are really extraordinary. For instance, imagine the number of times in the course of our lives that elastin, that is a protein that is characteristic of elastic properties and resilience, but imagine how many times the blood flows through our arteries and the constant stress and different pressures that is that it has to withstand in order to fulfill this to during the 80 or more years of our time course. Or even think about the number of times that the fly flaps its wings and the performance that a protein like resilin needs to withstand to fulfill that role. And in these structural proteins are thus, as I mentioned, involved in structural protein functions. And one of the main characteristics is that they consist of short repetitive amino acid motifs, like for instance in elastin, this pentamer VPGVG, or in silk fibrin GAGAGS, or even in the keratin, this sequence. And these short repetitive motifs provide a structural element that accounts for the basic properties of the natural protein. And these short repetitive amino acid blocks form really specific secondary structures that later propagate in the entire polypeptide sequence and are thus responsible for the mechanical or the physical properties of the natural protein. And you can find these well-defined secondary structures in all of these structural proteins. For instance, the beta turn or beta spiral in resilin, that, as I mentioned, in the wing hinge from the insects. Beta turns and beta spirals are also present in proteins like elastin or the flashily formed silk, whereas, for instance, the fibrin and the dragline silk are comprised mainly beta sheets. So the secondary structures, well-defined secondary structures, are thus responsible for the physical properties, the mechanical properties of the natural proteins. Okay, wait a moment because something. Okay, so and in the case of these secondary structures, the beta turns are a structural feature of elasticity. This is found in elastin that confers elasticity to the mammalian tissues and organs. And the one of the requirements for protein elasticity is that the molecules must be flexible and conformationally free. So this is characteristic of amorphous structure. And since the beta turns are able to, they have a huge flexibility, in here we can see, let me just point, we can see in the relaxed form, and it is able to be extended in and then return to the relaxed state. So the beta turns are able to slide along the chain, and this confers the elasticity and the resilience of the protein-like elastin. In opposition, the beta sheets are a structural feature of rigidity. So these are found in silk fibrin to provide tensile strength, and these secondary structures are more stable than the other secondary structures due to a dense hydrogen bonding that provides a near perfectly alignment, as you can see in here from the figure of the structure. And this close internal packing does allows for a perfect order, so a crystalline structure. And this is a very important concept, that the perfect order is provides more tensile strength, whereas a more amorphous structure provides elasticity and resilience. And due to the inherent biocompatibility and remarkable mechanical properties, the natural protein-based materials can be fabricated into different types of structures. And in here we can find, for instance, silk or elastin. They can be fabricated into gels, microspheres or particles, films, fibers, and even tubes. And each of these materials can be applied for several different applications. This, and by this, I want to highlight the remarkable versatility of these materials for the development of new applications. However, this outstanding interest, for the successful application as products, the natural protein materials presents several limitations. For instance, the source must be abundant, efficient, and cost effective. However, the protein of interest is often present in relative low quantities. The extraction from the natural source is often difficult and expensive, and moreover, the extraction methods may alter or destroy the desired properties. So one alternative is to follow a biotechnology approach involving the recombinant protein production. And by recombinant DNA technology, it is possible to produce synthetic proteins, the recombinant protein polymers, the RPPs, by exploiting the 20 naturally occurring amino acids by following a de novo design. And one of the main interesting abilities is that we can follow a modular design. So we can follow a multi-block assembly. This allows to combine in the same protein two or more distinct properties. And these proteins can be prepared by recombinant DNA technology involving gene construction and microbial expression by fermentation that allows the production of polymers with precise composition, sequence, and length. And this is very, very important because in material science or polymer science, it is very hard to have a complete control over the composition, sequence, and length. So this provides an added advantage over chemical synthesis. As an example, for instance, of the multi-blocks assembly, and let's say a block approach, we have the amino acids sequence inspired by nature. So we design the complementary DNA coding sequence, and in here we can have a schematic representation of the modular design in which we can add several different blocks to achieve a protein showing different functionalities or by assembling different blocks into the same protein. And then this is transformed into microbial cell factor followed by the production of the recombinant protein polymer. So in our research group in the SYNBIO Tech group, we will focus mainly in the structural domains comprising elastin-like blocks, structural domains comprising silk-like blocks, that is elastin-like by the sequence VPAVG, that allows the formation of beta spirals, the silk-like block comprising the hexamer GAGAGS that leads to the formation of beta sheets, and also functional domains, for instance, antimicrobial peptides or cell adhesion motifs. So by following this rational design that I mentioned earlier, we can join, for instance, antimicrobial peptides as functional domain with elastin-like sequences as structural domain, and in the end, we can have a protein polymer with antimicrobial activity. And those referring to elastin-like blocks, we call them elastin-like recombinomers. And in opposition, we can join the elasticity of the elastin blocks with the tensile strength of the silk blocks to combine both the elasticity and the tensile strength in one single molecule. And these are called the silk elastin-like proteins. And in our group, we have been devoted to the exploitation of the elastin, the ELR, the elastin-like recombinomers, and the silk elastin proteins, so the silk elastin-like proteins, the SELPs, to different applications. For instance, in the ELRs, by using these proteins as fusion tags, we have developed some interesting case studies for textile applications. By exploring, and I will mention that before later, by using this specific property of these proteins to self-assemble into microparticles, we employed we explored this for the encapsulation of drugs for drug delivery purposes. And by adding functional groups, we developed some antimicrobial materials. As for the SELPs, or as I mentioned, the silky elastin-like proteins, we developed several different sequences, and we processed by different techniques to achieve different types of materials. For instance, solvent casting to produce freestanding films, electrospinning to produce fiber mats, or by compounding to have or to develop multifunctional composites. So regarding the application of recombinant protein polymers and specifically the elastin-like recombinomers, first a brief introduction, what are the elastin-like recombinomers? These are the family of repetitive artificial biopolymers based on the sequence of the mammalian tropoelastin. And they all exhibit a smart thermoresponsive behavior. That is, for instance, that lower temperatures below a specific threshold that we call the transition temperature, the polymer chains are extended, and so the protein polymer is soluble. But as soon as the temperature rises above this transition temperature, they aggregate and become by folding to a spiral and become unsolvable. So this is called the inverse temperature transition. And we can explore this for instance, for purification purposes. In our lab, although the main sequence of the elastin is based, of the tropoelastin is based on the VPG-VG sequence, we made an alteration and we replaced the central glycine by an alanine. And this conferred a thermal esterases behavior. So the protein is able also to transit from the soluble to the insoluble state. And I forgot to say that this is completely reversible. And in the laboratory, we, at least more than 30 times. In this specific case of the VPAVG, what happens is that the protein polymer is able to is soluble, is able to self-assemble into particles, but it remains stable with these particles stable through a range of temperatures. For instance, this is the differential scanning colorimeter study that shows that, and this is the degrees and this is the heat flow. What happens is that when we heat the solution, it self-assembles, and this is represented by endothermic peak, as I'm pointing here, and self-assembles at near 33-34 degrees. And if we cool down the solution, it only resolubilizes, it only turns soluble at more or less 14 degrees. This allows to have near particles that are stable at this range of temperatures, so at the handling temperatures. So in this case, this can be explored for different applications that I'm going to show in the next slides. So for the construction of this poly-VPAVG, it consists of 200 repetitions of the pentamer VPAVG. So this is a schematic representation of the overall process we used to obtain the final polymer. So it involves a recursive directional ligation that comprises a series of restriction, digestion, and ligation reactions. And in the end, after obtaining the final gene constructs, the copolymer was produced in E. coli. And as I mentioned, this ability to self-assemble into spherical nanoparticles that segregate from the solution, and due to the reversibility of the process, we can use the simple hot and cold cycles or steps followed by hot and cold centrifugations to purify the protein polymer. This is a small video showing the process in real time, what happens. So as we heat, once it reaches above the 34 degrees, it segregates from the solution, and then we can centrifuge it to collect these particles, these the self-assembled particles that are then resolubilized in cold water, and then we centrifuge again to get rid of the contaminants. And in this process, in the end, we can have a fully pure protein polymer, so protein fraction. And we explore this property, this remarkable process for different applications. So we explore for textile, biomedical, and protein purification, and even antimicrobial materials. And one of the cases that we use, was for by using this VPAVG, these 200 repetitions of the VPAVG as a fusion tag for to restrict the hydrolysis of recombinant subutilizing to the surface of wool fibers. So what is the problem? In one of the main problems in wool treatments, in the wool processing, is the wool fibers need to be treated in order to remove these scales, okay? And these scales are usually removed by chlorination. But chlorination that use chloride has remarkable, has a huge eco impact, has negative impact, ecological impact. So we have to find alternatives. And alternatives, they exist, for instance, by using enzymes. But the main problem is that the enzymes attack the core of the fiber, and so they destroy completely the fiber. So our rationale was to use this VPAVG 200 as a fusion tag, and at 37 degrees, it self-assembles into spherical particles that they have the subutilizing in here that is free to act, but these particles will restrict the action of the enzyme to the surface of the wool fiber. And we, after several and several tests, this is, for instance, FITCSA that's showing that, in fact, the action is limited to the surface of the wool fibers. But I guess this picture speaks for itself, okay? This is same images of fibers with no enzymatic treatment, these ones. Fibers treated with a commercial protease in order to overcome the problem of the chlorination. And in here, we have the fibers treated with our recombinant enzyme. And as we can see, in here, the commercial protease simply, well, the fibers are completely destroyed. And so the image is quite clear in this aspect. And besides showing the structural integrity, like the fibers with no enzymatic treatment, we also saw an improved softness, shrink resistance, and diability. And I forgot to say that chlorination, or this treatment of the fibers, is quite important to avoid not only the shrink of the wool materials, but also to improve the diability of these fabrics. We also explored these particles for drug delivery purposes, and for this we used the particles to encapsulate bone morphogenetic proteins using a green approach. That is, we only use heating, 37 degrees, and PBS. So it's quite eco-friendly. And this is briefly what we use for the encapsulation. We have a solution of the VPAVG 200. We add the growth factors, bone morphogenetic protein 2 and bone morphogenetic protein 14. We just heat it. And then we can collect the particles by centrifugation. And in here you can see a same image of the particles. And after testing, we saw that the particles were highly effective in promoting the osteogenic calcification or mineralization, as demonstrated here by the alizarin red staining. And inclusively, due to the sustained release of the bone morphogenetic proteins, we achieved even results even better than just by adding the soluble free bone growth factors into the medium. Another approach was by functionalization of the VPAVG200, the 200 repetitions of VPAVG with antimicrobial peptides. And in this, so by genetically engineering the structure of the protein polymer, we incorporated an antimicrobial, several antimicrobial peptides, and then we process, after production and purification, we process these materials into films by solvent casting and fibers by electrospinning. And due to the thermal hysteresis of the VPAVG, these materials are stable at handling temperature without the need to add extra chemical cross-linking steps. So analysis of the antibacterial activity clearly demonstrate that both the films and the fibers are highly effective in disrupting the microbial membranes. So we can see here that the microorganisms simply they are completely disrupted, so they are they lyse. We also saw that these materials are quite effective in promoting an antifungal activity against different species of Candida, and even against, and this is filamentous fungi, Aspergillus needleworms. And a remarkable aspect is that these materials don't show any cytotoxicity. So this is some examples of using the VPAVG or the elastin-like recombinomers as for the development of materials. And in this case, we improved the ability or the functionality of the protein polymer for itself by adding antimicrobial domains, or by using it as a fusion tag to restrict the hydrolysis of the subtilisin, and or by using it as a drug delivery device. As for the silky elastin-like proteins, well, the concept was to develop new protein-based copolymers using silk-like rigid and elastin-like flexible blocks. And these would confer, first, the proteins to be fully soluble in water due to the water solubility of the elastin-like blocks, and also to improve the mechanical strength of materials by the incorporation of the silk-like blocks. So this is the rationale for for gene construction. The self consists of 5 silk-like repeating blocks fused with 9 elastin-like repeating blocks, and all of this is repeated 9 times. So in here we have a schematic representation of the fully protein polymers. So it consists of basically of 9 tandem repetitions of 5 blocks fused with 5 silk blocks fused with 9 elastin blocks. So we used here for the production, we used from E. coli as cell factory. We developed a purification protocol consisting only of 2 steps, an acid-based step to disrupt the remaining E. coli cells and to precipitate most of E. coli endogenous proteins, followed by ammonium sulfate precipitation to achieve a pure cell fraction. And in here we can see a real photo of some of a production and purification that we have made. We then processed these pure materials by electrospin for the production of fibers, by solvent casting for the production of freestanding films, and due to the presence of the silk blocks, these materials are able to self-assemble into and produce hydrogel. So the silk blocks, due to the repetition of the GA-GA-GS sequence, they are able to form beta sheets that will lead to a physical cross-linking that results in the formation of hydrogels that are irreversible once formed. So, as by electrospinning, we produce some fibers. In here, we have a different assortment of different structures. We have, for instance, at low concentrations, the formation of beads of particles by following an electrospray process. In here, we have the formation of both particles and fibers, and in here, in this case, these are defective, but we at concentrations from 13% to above, we have a control over the fiber diameter, and from 150 nanometers up to 300 nanometers. And we explore this for the properties. We characterize for the properties for skin regeneration purposes, namely as wound healing dressings. And we have here some different properties. We can see that they have the water vapor transmission rate of about 1,000 grams per cubic meter per day. Regarding its wetting properties, they are relatively hydrophilic. They show a water uptake swelling degree of more than 500%, and the fiber mats show no cytotoxicity in normal human skin fibroblasts, and were able to support cell adhesion and proliferation. And altogether, these properties should suggest that these cell membranes can be used for skin regeneration applications, especially for moderated wounds. Also, as I mentioned, one of the remarkable properties is the presence of the silk blocks that leads to the formation of hydrogels. And with the appropriate composition and concentration, the cells are able to spontaneously form hydrogels. And depending of the concentration, we can have soft hydrogels or more hard hydrogels. Moreover, by changing the concentration and the heating for this process, self-assembly process, this gelation process to occur, we can have hydrogels with different morphologies. For instance, in here we can have like a fiber-like pore, while the increased pore size can be attained by increasing the concentration. And the heating temperature also resulted in different, as you can see here, resulted also in different pore morphologies. So to highlight the high versatility of these protein polymers for the development of different materials, we also processed into films by solvent casting while using deionized water, just water, okay, or formic acid as solvents. And the cast films were optically transparent to visible light, and I'll mention that in the next slide. And this is a real photo of the materials that we obtained, okay? These are my hands. So this is really one type of the material, photo of the type of materials that we are able to obtain. And in here we can see also that they are quite transparent, and so this is also an important feature. So the films demonstrate to be electrically insulating with a value quite near mica, for instance, or rubber. They are demonstrated to be quite transparent in the visible light region. However, they are opaque to the ultraviolet type UV light. And they were also, regarding the thermal degradation, they were also quite resistant since the thermal degradation only begins at temperatures higher than 220 degrees, with effective thermal degradation being achieved at 340 degrees. Additionally, the materials also demonstrated to possess properties close to PLA. So PLA, the polylactic acid, is a commonly used bioplastic. And here, by comparing, we can see that these materials display properties near the mechanical properties of PLA. And it was also non-cytotoxic for the normal human fibroblasts. So these good mechanical properties, thermal stability, absence of cytotoxicity, and versatility of this processing suggested us for that we could use, and the versatility of processing mainly, that we could use these materials for the development of multifunctional composites. And so we developed some different biocomposites by adding silver nanoparticles for the development of antimicrobial materials. Essential oils, we also developed some composites with essential oils for the development of active biocomposites. By adding a recombinant protein polymer functionalized with a cell adhesion domain, we were able to achieve materials with improved cell adhesion, while the incorporation of carbon nanotubes led to the development of piezo-resistive materials. And regarding the antimicrobial cell composites, by adding a silver salt at three different concentrations, namely 1, 3, and 5%, into a SELP, aqueous SELP solution. Then we process the material by electrospinning, or the protein solution by electrospinning, or by solvent casting to achieve fibers or films. Electron backscattering analysis that we can see here reveal the presence of brilliant dipots, as we can see from the figure, that shows in the fibers and the ear in the films, these brilliant dipots that confirm that the presence of silver particles with approximately 10 nanometers in the fibers and 30 nanometers in the films. And this was further confirmed by energy dispersive spectroscopy, by EDS, that clearly, as we can see here in the fibers, they clearly show the peaks regarding the formation of silver particles and here in the films. So by adding a silver salt, we are able to produce composites with the formation of silver nanoparticles without adding any additional reducing compound. Analysis of the antimicrobial performance revealed that both the fibers and the films were highly effective against all the bacteria tested, as you can see here by this measurement of the inhibition levels of the tests. Also, these materials mostly to be non-cytotoxic against normal human skin fibroblasts. So another approach to attain biocomposites was by adding essential oils. Essential oils are quite interesting because they exhibit an high assortment of different properties, for instance, anti-inflammatory, antimicrobial, antioxidants. And so we used the essential oil from Menta Piperita and blended with SELP for targeting the development of active biomaterials for wound dressing applications. So always using water as solvent, you produce some emulsions of menta piperita essential oil and the salp in water, followed by solvent casting, and we then evaluated antimicrobial performance. In here, we can see some of the essential oil droplets present in the salp matrix. Okay. Analysis of the antimicrobial performance revealed good antimicrobial performance against E. coli, Bacillus subtilis, and also against Staphylococcus aureus. So this indicates that these biocomposites are also quite effective against antimicrobial, against the microbial or pathogenic microbes. Another approach was to develop silk-based composites with improved cell adhesion. And for this, we used a spider silk composed of 6 repetitions of this amino acid sequence that was genetically fused with 3 fibronectin type 2 domains. And we used this construction as a filler, as an active filler with cell. So we blended these compositions at different concentrations so we could combine the superior mechanical strength on the cell adhesion properties of the 6 mer with the fibronectin type 2 domain with the processing ability of the cell. So in the end, we were able to achieve silk-based composites with the 6 mer FN2 as a filler. This was produced, so we produced some silk-based film composites by solvent casting. We added the SELP and the 6 mer FN2 at different concentrations, namely 5, 15, and 38%. And we assessed the cytotoxicity against normal human skin fibroblasts that showed no remarkable cytotoxic effect against all the concentrations. And by following the biological performance by namely cell adhesion, since the FN2 fibronectin type 2 is characteristic for cell adhesion purpose, we tested with different concentrations and of the filler, and we proved that concentration of 15% is critical for cell adhesion. And by comparing with a positive control, we can see that the results are quite similar, whereas the cell shows no cell adhesion and the 6 mer for itself also demonstrates no cell adhesion. So by using this functionalized silk-based protein polymer with this silk elastin-like protein polymer as a structural model, as a structural matrix, we are able to obtain a biocomposite with improved cell adhesion. As the last example, although these materials are quite interesting from a biological point of view, lack some specific physically active properties. Like, for instance, they are insulating, and so in sometimes it is quite good to have a material that is able to be conductive. So we incorporated carbon nanotubes. Well, in fact, we incorporated not only carbon nanotubes, but also cobalt ferrite nanoparticles. But in here, I will show only the carbon nanotubes. And the carbon nanotubes were used to confer a piezoelectric response to the materials. And in the other case, the cobalt ferrite nanoparticles were used to have materials with magnetic properties. But I will focus only in these ones with the piezoelectric response. So we use the cell as a structural matrix, as a base matrix, and we add carbon nanotubes at 3 different concentrations, 1, 3, and 6. Same analysis revealed an overall homogeneous distribution of the nanoparticles into the polymer matrix, and the TGA thermogravimetric analysis demonstrates that no differences are attributed to the presence of particles regarding the thermal degradation of the material. By comparing the mechanical properties, we observe that the introduction or the incorporation of 100% of carbon nanotubes resulted in a six-fold increase in the strain to failure properties, so in the mechanical properties, and showing a stress strain characterized by a linear region of elastic behavior and a plateau related to uniform plastic deformation. And importantly, we assess the electrical and electromechanical response of the biocomposites. And what we saw in briefly, it was that the incorporation of carbon nanotubes greatly improved the electrical conductivity. As if you remember, the cell-based materials are insulating with properties near rubber, and the incorporation of carbon nanotubes greatly improved the conductivity of these materials. And regarding the piezo-resistive behavior, a piezo-resistive behavior is, if I apply an electrical stimuli, what happens is that the material deforms physically, and vice versa. So if I deform the material, it will respond with an electrical response or electrical, response output. So in here, what we assess was that the deformation of the material corresponded very similar with a very similar electric response, electric output. So in brief, this means that the PS, this behavior were characterized by high reliability performance and sensitivity, meaning that it is appropriate for sensors that work at low deformations. So in here, if we apply that is here in blue, as you can see, a deformation, it translates into an electric response in red. And as you can see, the deformation, the electric response follows exactly the same path as the deformation. So finally, we also assess, and since we were devising a biomedical application, we assess the cell viability or the cytotoxicity of these materials that showed no cytotoxicity against normal human cells. Finally, and I think I am a bit over time, so the recombinant protein polymers are sustainable. They present these properties, they are sustainable, they can be custom designed, they possess a high versatility of processing, they are biocompatible and eco-friendly, and moreover, we can further improve the properties of these materials by functionalization with active fillers that can lead to a new generation of multifunctional bio-inspired materials. To end, I would like to thank, I think maybe I forgot some people, but overall, I want to thank all the people that were involved in these works that I was showing, as well as the institutions, namely CBMA and EBS, IBS, the Electroactive Smart Materials from the Department of Physics from the University of Minho and the School of Science, of course, the Bioforge group from the University of Valladolid and the University of Wollongong from Australia, from specifically Vitor Sancadas. I also would like to thank all the funding that was associated with this research. And thanks for your attention. So I finished.
Thank you, Raul.
But Professor Saleh, sorry for being a bit over time.
Yes, it was a bit long, very interesting indeed. I'm going to ask if anyone has questions for Raul.
I guess everybody's now is with a bit appetite, so.
Well, if I'd like to ask you something, Raul. It is really an incredible work you have been doing. What I'd like to ask is that what about the upscaling of the production of those proteins? How are you doing with that?
Well, the upscaling of recombinant proteins is always the major bottleneck of this kind for its applications. We are all already trying to overcome some of the limitations by employing industrial byproducts for media formulation, and we have really, really interesting results using industrial byproducts or industrial subproducts that can be used to decrease the value or the cost of the medium. We also developed some upscalable methods for purification, and inclusively we have already tested the production and purification of the salt proteins in 500 liters fermenters. So it's only a pilot scale, but well, we have good indications that we can reach a feasibility of the upscaling. Of course, we need to test it in higher reactors or bigger reactors, so to prove that it is feasible. But in the beginning, we are at a small scale. We are trying to overcome all the forecasting problems that we can have during the process, and trying to reduce costs and trying to optimize everything.
Okay, thank you. So if I'm not seeing anyone with a raised hand, so we end this. I thank you again for your talk and for your participation, and see you all in 2 weeks.
Okay. Bye.
Okay. Okay.
Thank you. Okay. We have one. No. No.
No. No.
No, we have just here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Sorry.
No. I think we have Carlos. Carlos, you are able to unmute yourself if you want.
I didn't have a question. I was just congratulations for the presentation, but no questions today. Thank you.
Okay.
Sorry. Thank you. Your hand was.
Okay. Okay. See you, Andrea.
Thank you. Hello.
Okay. Andrea, wait a minute because I want to talk with you. But okay. You can stop the recording.
Yeah. Okay.